Welcome to Tales at Scale, a podcast that cracks open the world of analytics projects. I'm your host, Rena from Imply, and I'm here to bring you stories from developers doing cool things with analytics, way beyond your basic BI, and I'm talking about analytics applications that are taking data and insights to a whole new level. On today's episode, we are doubling down on Apache Druid, when to use it, what to use it for, and where it fits in the very crowded database space. Apache Druid is a real-time analytics database designed for fast slice-and-dice analytics or OLAP queries on large datasets. When I say large datasets, I'm talking like petabytes of data. Thousands of companies are already using Druid today, from Netflix to Salesforce, but what is Apache Druid best for? What types of projects? What datasets are Druid users working with? And what are companies doing with Druid? Or maybe the better question is, what should they be building with Druid? To answer these questions, I am sitting down with David Wang, VP of Product Marketing at Imply, and Muthu Lalapet, Director of Worldwide Sales Engineering at Imply. David, Muthu, welcome to the show. Today, we're diving into Apache Druid and what makes it unique. It's kind of like our own, like how I built this episode for Druid. So, David, I'm going to start with you. When we had Eric Schetter on here, we talked about the origins of Druid and why it was built. To make it a very, very, very short story. At the time, there were none of the existing databases worked for what they needed. They just weren't fast enough. Fast forward to today, and there are like somewhere around 300 databases on the market. What separates Druid from the rest?
Hey, first of all, thanks so much, Farina, for having me on the show. That's a great question. There are a ton of databases out there. And, you know, reality, it's about a change of use cases. You know, when people think about analytics, what typically comes to mind are data warehouses. And so there's obviously been an evolution in data warehouse market from the Teradata, you know, on-prem appliances to Vertica to Snowflake to Databricks to Presto Trino. But all of those technologies all kind of fundamentally address the same exact workload, BI, business intelligence, the executive reports that, you know, every organization needs, every department uses for kind of historical look back reporting and dashboards. And that is not what Druid's all about. We're for something very special and something very different than that classical analytics workload.
So what would Druid be used for, though, if we're moving away from, you know, your traditional BI? Like, what are some of the, what are we looking for to use it? Where is it best suited?
Yeah, so I think it really speaks to kind of three core differentiators that separate Apache Druid from every other OLAP database out there. And we frame this up as analytics meets applications. Like, what does that mean? It's really about trying to do large-scale aggregation, group-by-type queries on high cardinality, high-dimensional data, but doing that with the responsiveness of an application, doing that with the concurrency that you would expect of a user-facing application, doing that on operational real-time streaming events. And that's where it's something very different, because when you have a lot of data and you want to be able to crunch that really quickly against a data warehouse, you're going to probably look at shortcuts like building an OLAP cube, for example, or only analyze the most recent data or rely on an aggregation and then slice and dice off the aggregation. But when you're trying to do analytics that involve lots and lots of data, but you have to have that really fast responsiveness, then that's where Druid comes in. And of course, real-time data is a very big element for Druid too. That's, you know, driving a lot of the use of Apache Druid.
I was actually just going to ask you, like, why don't data warehouses or maybe like a data lakehouse, you know, fit the bill? But if we're talking about a whole new use case, that totally makes sense to me. Muthu, you know, you get to work on like the things that David just explained, right? Because you handle proof of concepts for us. And so you get to see like some of those use cases manifested in real life. Before we get into, you know, examples, when companies come to Imply, what challenges are they facing? What are they kind of asking us for help with?
Sure, definitely. Before I get started, I want to let everyone know that I love that How I Built This podcast from Guy Raz. It's a pretty good one. And I listened to the first episode of The Tales of Scale with Eric, and that was a good one too. All right, so as part of working at Imply for the last close to 4 years, I've done implementations, and now I'm heading up the sales engineering team, where I get to see all the POCs that we execute on a day-to-day basis. Right? Like you said, I get to see what our prospects or customers want to do with their data. And mostly it falls under those three buckets that David called out, right? They want to do sub-second analytics on petabytes, if not terabytes, of data. And also doing real-time analytics. Generally, it's with Kafka or Kinesis, sometimes with Pulsar as well, right? And most importantly, it's about providing customer-facing analytics. When it comes to customer-facing analytics, your queries have to be really, really fast. It also has to support concurrent queries. That means a lot of users will be accessing the application, right? That means your system should be in a position to support thousands of concurrent queries at the same time. So mostly it falls into these three buckets, if not two buckets, when prospects come to us.
When we talk about some of these use cases, one that comes to mind off the top of my head is operational visibility at scale. And maybe it's just because this is the name of the podcast, but let's kind of go into that one to kind of start us off. When someone is looking to, you know, build applications to help with that, what kind of data sets are they looking with? What are they trying to solve?
Instead of looking into a particular data set or a use case, I'm going to give you some examples around what we have seen. Is that okay?
I love examples. Right? Go for it.
All right. Before I talk about examples, let's talk about what operational visibility really means, right? We all heard the term about operations. So what do operations mean? Operations is generally a work of managing the inner workings of something, right? Inner workings of a business or inner working of a department or a component or a particular unit inside a company, right? How do these operations people do their day-to-day work? What they normally do is they define some metrics around what they are measuring. They collect the data and they analyze that particular data. And that's how they make decisions on a day-to-day basis using this operations metrics. So let me give you some examples. Think about a product manager. A product manager in a SaaS organization, they would want to know how their product is performing. Is it slow? Where are the customers getting stuck? Maybe they rolled out a new feature yesterday and they want to see how many people are using the new feature. Or they may be doing some A-B tests, right? So to do all this, they need to collect some metrics. Normally, in this kind of a use case, it is about clickstream events. So they will be collecting clickstream events on the SaaS product, where people are clicking, what things they're using, what they're not using. If your SaaS product is really popular, this could easily turn into billions of events per day. Let's think about Confluence. Now, I'm using Confluence on a day-to-day basis, Confluence is an Atlassian product. I'm using Confluence and Jira on a day-to-day basis. From a Confluence perspective, for their clickstream data, it would be like billions of events for a single day. So we need to build some kind of a system that actually measures its metrics, analyzes it, and gives it back to the product manager so they can make some decisions on a day-to-day basis. That's what we mean by operations. I'll give you another example, right? From a game developer perspective.
Okay, now you're speaking my language.
All right. You know what? I used to fancy myself as a game developer about 10 years back. I built a game as well in HTML5 about 10 to 12 years. It's like a boggle game. There used to be like 1,000 people playing every day. And in that game, you know, I tracked every event, every word a particular gamer was trying to make. And just with 1,000 users a day, I used to get about 50,000 to 60,000 events a day, right? Just with 1,000 users. Think about if your game is really popular and 20 million people are playing the game every day, then you'll be getting about 1 billion events a day, mm-hmm. Okay? So from a game developer's perspective, what they want to see is they want to see where the gamer is dropping off. Are the levels too hard? There could be like 20 or 100 levels. What does a funnel look like? 1,000 people came in, all 1,000 played level one, only 500 went to level two, right? So they want to see all that funnel analytics, retention ratios, what is the average revenue per user? All these are different insights that they want to see, and they want to make some decisions on how to make their game better, right? So that's what we mean by operations. So you're looking into data about your product or about your game, about something that you are measuring on a day-to-day basis, on a real-time basis, and trying to make some critical decisions, right? And then we talked about operations visibility. Right? What is visibility? From a game developer's perspective or a product manager, they are not like a day-to-day data analyst. They aren't going to be running SQLs or writing like 20 lines of SQL or 30 lines of SQL code and wait for 5 minutes or 10 minutes to get the results back. They want data to be presented in such a way that is easily accessible and easily analyzed, and it's really, really fast from a query perspective so that they can analyze the data and make some decisions and move on, right? So that's what we mean by operations visibility. Before I go to examples, Reena, I'm going to talk about what are the things that's needed to build a operational visibility application.
It's like you took the question right out of my mouth. Like, what do people need to build this?
Like I said, you know, my simple game, 1,000 people are playing, it's only about 50,000 events a day. But if millions of people are playing, it's about a billion events a day. So the first thing is you need to have a mechanism to collect this massive amounts of data. That's the first thing that you need. The second thing is most often these are real-time data because the analyst or the product manager want to see what's happening right now and then make a decision. So you need a real-time way of collecting these massive amounts of data. That's the second thing that you need. Mm-hmm. A third part is these operational analysts or the product managers are making decisions looking at this data, right? So it has to be the queries have to be really responsive. It has to be really, really fast. They don't have a 10 minutes or a 5 minute window to sit there and see and wait for the results. They want to know right away. And the fourth part, think about bigger game studios like EA or Tencent. You know, there could be thousands of product analysts and thousands of game managers who are looking into the data. That means the system should be in a position to support concurrent queries and a lot of users. So higher concurrency is very, very important. Mm-hmm. And finally, for the visibility part, you need to have an easy way to present this data back to them, an easy way so that they can understand and look at the data and make sense right away. So these are five things that you need to build a real good operational visibility application.
So we've been kind of talking about like the hypothetical, like, but do you have any examples of like, you know, current implied customers or folks that have done this at scale?
Oh yeah, absolutely. A lot of our implied customers are doing this at scale. One of them, I'm going to so fancy myself as a game developer right now, so let's talk about the gaming thing. One of our customers is Game Analytics. Game Analytics, for those of you who don't know, is the number one analytics tool for game developers. They provide insights for your games. If you are a game developer out there, you should definitely check them out. It's a great tool. Let me give you some stats around Game Analytics in a monitoring system. They monitor about 100,000 plus games in any given day. There are about 200 million daily active users playing the games that they are monitoring. Like I said, in my game with 1,000 users, it's about 50,000 events, and 20 million users, it could be 1 billion events. Think about 200 million daily active users playing a game, and that's what they're monitoring with the help of Druid. And they're also getting 20 billion events per day, 20 billion events per day. And they do this analytics on about 10 terabytes plus data per day. And that's the scale that we're talking about here.
That's crazy. I'm like trying to think of it, just trying to go through that. It, without something like Druid would be a lot. I'm understating it there.
It would be a lot, but they did. They tried to do this without Druid. Let me talk about what they did before and what was the challenge with that. And then we'll talk about how we fixed it, right? So what they did before is, you know, all these raw data, the raw events, they are coming from these games. When you play a game, there are lots of stuff the game developers are collecting. What are you clicking? What level you're playing? You know, all that they're collecting behind the scenes. That's what we call as the raw events. These raw events are getting into their you know, real-time system. They have a homegrown real, before Druid, they had a homegrown real-time tool for real-time processing. They do a lot of pre-computation in that particular tool. And they store all the data into DynamoDB. So for those of you who don't know, DynamoDB is a key value store that is really good for faster writing and also faster reading on a single key basis. But that's not what analytics is all about. So anyway, they use this key value store such as DynamoDB. And they stored all that pre-calculated events. The key thing is the pre-computed results. Mm-hmm. So what I mean by pre-computing is the pre-computing is about determining the queries the users are eventually going to make. So you're trying to be like some kind of a psychic here, right? You're trying to determine what queries the users are going to make, and then you're going to calculate the results of those queries ahead of time, and then you're going to store those results for faster retrieval into DynamoDB. Why you're doing that is DynamoDB is not good for analytics purposes. It's really good for faster reads and faster writes, no doubt, but not for analytical reasons. They cannot do group bias. They cannot do any filtering. They cannot do any dimensional filtering. It's really good for single record retrieval, not for doing analytics around multiple records. So they have to do a lot of this pre-computation much beforehand.
Well, that makes sense too. And that's why there are so many different databases on the market right now, because there's no like one database to rule them all, right? There's like several that do very specific things. And that's why Druid has its own sort of fit versus DynamoDB.
Absolutely. Not only that, in the previous solution, what they did is they also had another system for supporting historical queries. So the one for real-time queries and one for historical queries. So they add two different systems to support real-time and historical, and supporting higher concurrency was also an issue. And they faced challenges with query response time and also a lot of work that needs to be done in pre-calculating. And as the scale went up, the time it takes to pre-calculate the results also went up. That means they're not providing any real-time insights. That means the game developers and the game managers and the product managers cannot make any decisions looking at the data. They're looking at the data about 1 day or 2 days old, not like a real-time data. That's the challenge that they faced.
Mm-hmm. Right? And I mean, if there's anybody that's, you know, the most patient group of people, it's people playing games and game developers.
There you go. Yeah.
Very immense amount of patience when things go wrong.
So that's where Druid comes in, right? So Druid is really good about, like we said before, to provide subsequent analytics on terabytes of data, real-time analytics, and also for higher concurrency. They looked into multiple databases. One of the databases they looked into was a time series database. But the time series databases are really good at operating on the time dimension, but not necessarily good at operating on dimensions other than time, like filtering on other dimensions and grouping by other dimensions. They aren't good at it. And they looked at Druid. We helped them evaluate Druid as well. The major reason why they selected Druid is, number one, you can do real-time and historical analytics in Druid. You don't have to have two different systems. That reduced a lot of cost for them from preparing those ETLs, maintaining those systems, and things like that. Along with it, Druid provides direct integration with Kafka and Kinesis. They've been using Kinesis for the real-time pipeline, and we directly plug into Kinesis and we can ingest the data right away. So when an event shows up in Kinesis, you can query that data event in about a second, if not less than a second. And the third reason why they chose Druid is you do not have to do all those pre-computing the results. From my perspective, that is the biggest win here. Because when you're pre-computing results, you can pre-compute results for maybe 20 million records. But think about pre-computing results for 20 billion records. It's going to take time. You do not have to do that. They completely drop that component from their stack after they implemented Druid, because Druid takes care of that already for you on the ingestion and also on the query side. These are three reasons why they use Druid.
I mean, that sounds like a win-win all around, not to make like another like gaming pun. So I want to shift gears for a minute to talk about. So we talked about operational visibility at scale, which is more of an internal process, right? But on another reason that people are coming to us for expertise on Druid is for customer-facing analytics. They are providing a service for their customers to analyze and visualize their data. Can you tell me a little bit more about that?
Yeah, sure. Absolutely. Customer-facing analytics is really an important use case for us. And it is more prevalent than we think. And to be honest, we as individual consumers, we are using a lot of customer-facing analytics tools on a day-to-day basis. I'll give you some examples from my own personal thing, right? We all have used Google Maps, or still using Google Maps, right? Google Maps has a little known feature called a timeline. If you enabled it, you can go, it just records wherever you go, and you can go back in time and see where you went and things like that. So I clicked on the timeline, and I was looking at it for a couple of days back, and I've been using Google Maps from 2010, about 12 years, right? So I clicked on timeline. It showed me a little analytics on my timeline. It told me the last 12 years I visited about 2,000 places, and gave my top 10 as well. And guess what? I know I really like one of a small restaurant here in the valley. I live in Phoenix, and it's a small kitchen in the back of a grocery store. I know that I go there quite often, but you know what? I've been there about 190 days in the last 10 years. That's like half a year, right? That's a lot.
Are you their best? You're like must be one of their best customers. I wouldn't want to know that. I don't want to know how many times I go to Whole Foods in a week.
So that's an example of a consumer-facing analytics, right? I'm using Google Maps, and they're giving me analytics on where I'm going and how often I'm going there and what's my top 10 is. Another example I could give you is YouTube. We all have been using YouTube, and there's a feature in YouTube mobile app called Time Watched. If you click on that, it'll tell you how much time you've been watching and what your viewing behavior is. Right? I kind of looked into it, and then my viewing behavior is about 23 or 25 minutes a day. I've been watching YouTube like 30 minutes a day. That's my viewing behavior, right? So these are examples of consumer-facing analytics. I think I'm giving a lot of information about my
personal
YouTube behavior and things like that.
First of all, 23 minutes on YouTube is like nothing. So you're not giving too much information. I can't imagine how many people are listening right now who didn't know about these things or probably looking them up right now and are very surprised because I'm going to do that as soon as we're done with the show.
Definitely, definitely. I want to give one more example because this relates to the operational visibility too. So when we talk about operational visibility, what did I say? Operations is about looking into something and trying to make sure whether that something is working optimally, right? Mm-hmm. Lately, I have been very interested to see how my body is operating. So I want to see what's inside my body and how that's operating. So to make that happen, you have to collect some metrics, right? So I'm collecting some metrics about my body on a day-to-day basis, on a real-time basis. So I'm using something called a continuous glucose monitor. It's from a company called NutriSense. Again, I'm not diabetic or anything like that, but I want to monitor my food intake and what's the impact it has on my glucose levels so I can alter my eating behavior and food habits and things like that. So I'm doing my own operational visibility on my own body right now, right? But anyway, this also ties back to the consumer-facing analytics. This NutriSense app gives me real good dashboards on a day-to-day basis and tells me how am I doing, what's my metric was 2 days back or 5 days back on a weekly average, monthly average, right? And what food is bad for me, what food is good for me. So it gives me a lot of good analytics. These are the examples of consumer-facing analytics I'm talking about, right? So me as an individual, I've been using all these apps. I'm used to all this consumer-facing analytics. So let's say now I go to office and I'm working from home, but now I go to my office room and log into Imply. And say I'm using a SaaS product. Let's say Confluence, right? Confluence or Jira from Atlassian. Mm-hmm. And I create a wiki on Confluence, let's say. And if I don't see analytics on my wiki, I will be super bummed because on a day-to-day basis, I'm seeing all my viewing behavior, my glucose behavior, my sleep behavior. But now I'm using something at workplace. And if that something is not giving me analytics based on what I'm doing, I'll be really mad at it, right? But good for Confluence, so they do provide the analytics for their product. So that's what we mean by user-facing analytics. Yep, that's it.
Well, I mean, Muthu, you're the most optimized human being I think I've ever met. Fully optimized. I mean, David, you're training for a triathlon. Maybe you need some of these. Maybe you need some of these customer-facing analytics to optimize your triathlon performance.
Absolutely. I mean, I obviously do look all that data as well. I think there's something to be said, though, in terms of like how does that change requirements, right? Because if you are a developer, architect charged with building a externally facing analytics application, does that actually change the requirements on what your backend data store needs to do? And I think that's something that's really important for us at Imply, because as we think about how people use Druid, that's a really important choice point, because I think, you know, Muthu, tell me, you know, what you think otherwise, but I do think the requirements on the underlying data store is much different when you're talking about serving customers than when you're just simply serving internal stakeholders.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Yeah. That's what I'm going to talk about next, right? So what is that you need to do to build this kind of a customer-facing analytics application? The first thing is you need to have a system that supports low latency queries. No one wants to open up a YouTube app and click on something and wait for 10, if not even for 5 seconds. Otherwise, you're going to go to some other streaming system, right? Same thing here. It has to be low latency. A query should be really, really fast. I don't want to open up an app and go to the analytics section of the app and wait for 10 seconds there. That's number one. Number two, higher concurrency. Think of these apps, right? There are lots of sleep tracking apps. Almost everybody is using those nowadays. So a lot of people are using Fitbits or Oura. So these apps are going to get thousands of queries in any given moment, in any given second. So these apps should be in a position to support higher concurrency even for the analytics workload. A third, you have to have an easy way to present the analysis back. So you're getting a small screen in a mobile system or in a web system, and also you're talking about general consumers here and the other examples. But from the enterprise consumers, you're talking about product managers or analysts, you need to have an easy way to show that massive amounts of data. You need to synthesize that and present it in a concise way. The fourth one, in almost all the cases, is all real-time data. They want to know what's happening right now, like the glucose monitor. I said, I want to know what's happening right now. I just ate something in the morning. I want to know what's happening. Maybe I ate a cookie, right? I want to know what's the impact on that in my body from the glucose level perspective. So I want to know what's happening right now. So real time is a really critical part of these things. So these four, low latency, higher concurrency, real time data, and the easy way to present this data back to the consumer is really, really important. I'm going to move on to, you know, giving a kind of a specific example.
I was just going to ask you that. I think one that might come to mind, I mean, I know we've mentioned them a few times, is Atlassian, right? Because, spoiler, they're a customer. So we have some good insights on there. But can you use them as an example?
Absolutely. So Atlassian, I think everyone knows who Atlassian is. For those of you who don't know, they have a product called Confluence. They have other products like Jira too, but let's focus on Confluence. Confluence is Atlassian's cloud-based wiki and a collaboration tool that they sell to enterprises, right? So we are a customer of Confluence. That implies we use Confluence, and every team uses Confluence to create wiki pages, right? One thing that Confluence provides is when you go to the wiki page that you created or anyone else created, you would have noticed that at the right below the title, it says how many people have viewed the page. And you hover over that or you click on that, you get a little bit more detailed analytics, like what is a view over time, right? Who are the top contributors? Who are the top commentators? So you get all this analytics on your wiki page. That entire analytics is backed by Druid. Like I said, that analytics application should be in a position to support higher concurrency. Think about Confluence. Confluence has 250,000 customers all across the world. If you assume there are about 40 people in each of them using it, that's about 10 million individual users. And if just 10% of that click on that analytics on any given moment, that's about millions of queries that you're going to get to the system. So they need to support higher concurrency.
Well, I was going to say, weren't they on Postgres before? Like, I have a feeling, yeah, before Druid.
They were on Postgres. You're correct. They're on Postgres before. I'll talk about what challenges that they faced. But let me talk about the scale first so that people understand
the
challenge.
It's the name of the show. Right? Tell me all the scale.
Exactly. It's the name of the show, right? So that's why I want to focus on the scale. Right? So the first scale, like I talked about, is like millions of queries coming at any given point in time. The second thing is the Confluence is a cloud-based product. It's a SaaS product. It's a web-based product. It's a web-native product. So your system should be really, really fast. It should be in sub-second. So when you click on something, it should respond right away. So sub-second query response time is really important to their use case. The third thing is, how are they making all this analytics happen? They're collecting all the clickstream data. They're collecting on who's clicking on the wiki page, what is the top wiki page, how many people are contributing. So that means clickstream data. It's a massive amount of data and real time as well. So higher concurrency, low latency queries, and real time. All these are the three different things that they need to solve. But before coming to Druid, they were using Postgres, like you said, Rina. Their architecture looks something like this. They collected clickstream events from Confluence. They pushed it into what they called as a real-time processing hub. They were also using Kinesis. And they do some processing on top of it. They augment some data. And they push the data back to Kinesis. And then there is something called some service process. Think of them as ETL. They take the data out of Kinesis, do some ETL work, prepare the data for Postgres, and then write it to Postgres. That's what their architecture was before Druid. But I'll tell you what, there are challenges in this architecture, like what we discussed about game analytics. Number one, Postgres is an OLTP database. It's not an analytical processing database. So they are good at processing any OLTP database. It's good at processing a single row. What I mean by single row is I want to select an employee record where employee ID equal to 51. Right? By the way, that's my employee ID at employ. Right? So that's a single record. So they're good at processing a single record. But they're not good at, let me give you another example. Not the employees, by the way. They're not good at aggregating or grouping by queries. I'm not able to give an example on the fly right now, but they're not good at aggregating and grouping by examples where they have to munch through a large number of records. But that's what the Confluence use case is all about. So OLTP databases are really not good at processing larger sets of data. Because of that, they were getting slower query response time. A lot of queries they were performing at 60-second, if not about 70-second range, and their entire Confluence analytics page was showing that spinning wheel of death, whatever we call that, right? It's still loading.
We all live in fear of the spinning wheel of death.
That's one of the challenges they face with PostgresDB. The second challenge is the PostgresDB does not support real-time data. I told you about that existing architecture where the data is coming in Kinesis and they have an ETL that takes data out of Kinesis, does some ETL work, prepares the data and puts it into Postgres. So they need to do pre-processing in that ETL step to prepare the data out of Kinesis and then write it to Postgres. They're spending a lot of resources on that. When I say resources, it's not only about machine resources, it's also about human resources, right? Maintaining, creating, developing, bug fixing, all that. They're spending a lot of time on that as well to prepare the data. And the third challenge that they faced is concurrency. When they were supporting thousands of customers, that's great, but now they're like supporting 250,000 customers worldwide, and Postgres is not meeting the challenge when it comes to concurrency. These are three challenges what they faced in building that application.
With all these examples, and one thing that, you know, I can't overstate this, we're talking about massive amounts of data, right? We're talking about huge data sets, especially now with the prevalence of real-time data. And so one thing, you know, is that Druid is being used for and that Druid's well suited for is rapid drill down and exploration, right? Because you need to kind of figure out what's going on and how do you even deal with that. Do you have any examples that you could share about rapid drill down or how that would work? Because I feel like that's pretty critical into how people make decisions. And it seems to be a challenge, I think, that has been coming up more recently.
Sure, we can definitely talk about that. But I want to address how Druid solved Confluence challenges, and then I'll definitely talk about the rapid drill down. So I told you that in PostgresDB, they are doing a lot of pre-processing to prepare the data to ingest into PostgresDB from Kinesis. But in Apache Druid, you have a direct connector to Kinesis. You don't have to do all the pre-processing. You simply point to Kinesis stream and say how the data looks like, define your schema, and you can do a little bit of a transformations, not a problem at all. And Druid can ingest the data right away, and it will make that event queryable in about less than a second, that you can run analytics queries on that real-time data combined with historical data as well. So one of the challenges on that is solved. The second thing I talked about is concurrency. Like I said before, there are about 250,000 customers they support, and could be easily about 10 million individual users. And they're getting close to about million queries a day. And Druid is really capable of handling all this concurrency because of our unique scatter-gather approach that we built in our Druid system. And the third thing, issues that they faced, like I said before, it is Postgres was an OLTP database. It's really good at parsing at a single row. But whereas Druid is a columnar database, the fundamental design in Druid is a columnar database. And we are engineered to process multiple records at the same time and provide all the analytical functions like aggregates and group bys and filtering on top of it. So using Druid, they're able to solve all those three challenges. And their queries are responding in about less than a second right now. That's a clear win for Atlassian, for their customers, and also for the end users like me who's using Atlassian on a day-to-day basis.
Let me just recap there. So pre-Druid, sometimes it could take up to 60 or 70 seconds. And now they're running at sub-second.
Now they're running about close to a second, close to a sub-second. It's about a second like that, yeah.
Wow, that is a massive improvement.
Massive, yeah.
Okay, so I'm jumping ahead because I want to pick your brain literally about every possible scenario that we can use Druid for and where it performs best. So like I said, let's get into rapid drill down. I have data on the brain right now. And so how does that work with Druid? How is Druid suited for that? Especially when we're dealing with, like I said, massive data sets.
Sure. Before I give you examples, let's talk about why we need this capability, why we need a rapid drill down our self-service analytics capabilities at all, right? So a couple of years back, I worked for a big insurance company, you know, great company. I still love them. I was helping them to build a data warehouse system. So this is what you generally see in any enterprise. There'll be a data analyst team whose day-to-day job is to run queries against a data warehouse system using some BI tools and prepare data. Mm-hmm. And this data analyst will be probably, you know, in my team at the time, it's like 5 or 6 data analysts. But the entire team would be supporting the entire organization like product managers and operational analysts and actuaries, claims analysts, insurance product analyst, pricing analyst. So there are different kinds of analysts in an insurance organization, and their day-to-day job is to make decisions on how to price a product, how to price a coverage, how to adjudicate a claim, how to actuaries are looking into the future and trying to design the product for the future based on the data what they see today. So their day-to-day job is not to run some SQL code. Their day-to-day job is to make decisions on the data what they have. So what they normally do is they raise a request to my team and the team of data analysts. I will say, hey, you know, I want to see the policies in California, in this particular county, because some fire happened, let's say last year. For the last year, give me the list of policies. So data analysts will be going and running a SQL query on the data warehouse and getting the list of policy in a CSV or an Excel or something like that and share the data back to the product analyst. So this takes maybe probably 2 hours, 3 hours, if not like a day, right? Like I said, we have only about 6 data analysts supporting the entire organization. So sometimes the data analysts are busy working on something else, right? So the requests have to be queued. And now the product analyst looks into the data, and now he or she says, oh, this is great. Oh, by the way, can you just give me data only for this zip code and possibly people 40 plus, because that's our demographics, right? Now, 2 days has gone by, the data analyst now goes and looks at the data and runs some queries and gets the data back again. So like this back and forth, it goes for a couple of days, if not a couple of weeks, until the product analyst gets the data what they need to make the decisions. Right? This is really inefficient. I was like 12 years back, I was doing that. I was part of the data analyst team and I was managing the team, was doing that. So that was a general workflow. Even today I see in enterprises. So when you go to any enterprise, you can see the data leaders or the CIO or the CTO giving big mission statements saying that they want everyone to take decisions based on data, and they want to empower everyone in the enterprise to make appropriate decisions backed by data. That's a great statement to make, but almost everyone says that nowadays. But generally what happens in the enterprise is what I described below. I mean, what I described before, right? So there's a data analyst and you spend about a couple of days, if not a couple of weeks to get the data and make decisions. Yes, they are making decisions on data, but it's slow. Mm-hmm. It's taking time. And by the time they make the decisions, the market moved on. So they are making decisions on something that is not valid anymore. And lastly, they also need to look into massive amounts of data to make the decisions. So that's why this self-service rapid drill-down analytics is really, really important so that we can empower those product analysts, operational analysts, and the insurance company, like I said, the claims analysts, to make the decision right away with the data, what they have, which they can access directly rather than depending on a data analyst.
Mm-hmm. No, that makes sense. I mean, you know, back when everything was more batch oriented, right? And then, you know, most people were using something like Tableau, maybe that would have worked out a little bit better. But now there's no way. There's no way that that is sustainable. It's kind of funny, like that wasn't even that long ago. And it's thinking about it now, I can't imagine like how hard that must be to like try to live a data-driven culture within an organization and having to do things so manually.
Exactly. Yeah. And it's happening even today too. You'd be surprised. And lots of enterprises do that today as well.
Not like I'm trying to put data analysts out of a job or anything. I'm just saying.
let me tell you the challenges. Before we go to challenges, let me tell you what's needed to build that kind of a self-service analytics system or rapid drill-down system. Let's go back to the insurance company that I said. I worked there for about a couple of years. I know literally, you know, how we operated there. Even in an insurance company, you'll be dealing with massive amounts of data. It's terabytes of data. Now, you know, think about insurance companies nowadays. They are tracking, they are providing, they are giving you devices to monitor your vehicle usage and pricing your insurance based on that. That means they're getting data about your usage of your vehicle, real-time data about your driving patterns. That's massive amounts of data. So first thing that they need is they need to have a system to analyze this massive amounts of data. The second thing is the low latency queries. If you're giving a self-service analytical system to, or a rapid drill-down system to an end user, like a product analyst, an operations analyst, they don't want to click on some widget and wait for 10 seconds or 20 seconds. They want to make the decision right away. So they want to just see the query happening immediately, in sub-second if possible. And number three, again, higher concurrency. You might have only six data analysts. It's okay if the queries perform slow, if you have only six people running massive queries, and that's completely fine. But think about 200 different analysts, product analysts, pricing analysts in the insurance company, let's say claims analysts, actuarial analysts, 200 different people accessing the system at the same time to get some insights. That's a lot of queries. Mm-hmm. That small insurance company is 200 people, but think about bigger companies. Like there are thousands of people querying the system on a daily basis. So concurrency is really, really key. The last part is to have a very unified and a consistent user interface that can provide you the self-service and the rapid drill-down capabilities on the data. Right? These are the four things that you would need to build that kind of a system. So far, we talked about what the self-service is, what rapid drill-down really mean. We addressed the challenges and what's needed to build such kind of a system. Mm-hmm. I'm going to give you an example. One of our customers who did that using Imply. Twitch is one of our customers. For those of you who don't know, Twitch is an Amazon company. I think most of us know Twitch. Mm-hmm. Twitch is a platform for live video streaming. It started off with live video streaming, but it kind of now you can do anything live, like cooking shows and music shows and live Q&A and things like that. But the leading driver for the Twitch web traffic is their video gaming live streaming, and they also conduct live esports and things like that. Mm-hmm. It's a pretty good site. To give you an understanding of the scale, because I want to talk about the scale because our podcast name is Tales at Scale, right?
Mm-hmm. I love that we keep bringing it back to that.
Exactly, yeah. The numbers here are like, they have about, this is about 2 years back data, 2 years back stats. It could be much more now after the pandemic and everything. It's about 4 million plus unique creators streaming each month and 20 million plus average daily visitors. 20 million plus average daily visitors. That's what we're talking about here. And from actual event data, it's about close to about 10 billion events data per day. 10 billion events, right, that they're tracking on a daily basis, not on a monthly, on a daily basis. That results into about 1.3 terabytes of raw data per day. And there are almost about 70,000 to 100,000 queries that they need to support internally. I'm not talking about external here. They want to give an analytics to their internal product analyst. It's about 70,000 to 100,000 queries a day that they want to support. That's the kind of a scale that we're talking about here.
That's kind of, I can't even like process those numbers, but everything on the consumer side just seems like everything flows so easily. We never think about on the user side how many events we're creating, right?
That's true. I want to stress on the number of events because that's in the billions. Like I said, the small game that I developed was generating 50,000 events per day. You're like 20 million visitors. You're tracking almost everything, where they're passing, where they're forwarding, where they are increasing the speed of the the video. So all that events you're tracking, that results into about 10 billion events a day. That's massive. First of all, to build that system, you need a system that can ingest that 10 billion events a day seamlessly without any issues. So you, in some systems, you can ingest, but you won't be ingesting the latest data. You'll be ingesting a data that happened 30 minutes, if not 2 hours back. But they want to see what's happening right now. So you want to have a system that actually ingests the data and will allow the users to query the data right away. That's really, really key. The second thing they would need is to have a system that can query across this terabytes of data. On a single day, it's 1.3 terabytes of data. Think about like 6 months. That's easily running in hundreds, if not 200 of terabytes of data. So you need to provide a system that can allow the analyst to query across these data sets. The third thing, like I said before, concurrent users. 70 to 100,000 queries a day, that's lots of queries that they're going to fire on a single day. And lots of concurrent queries, lots of concurrent users. I need to have a system that could support it. And finally, a system that could have a consistent user interface, easy data exploration, so they can look into not only what's happening today, but compare it to what happened to yesterday, what happened to 1 week back or 1 month back. An easy and a consistent user interface to support those kind of data explorations is also really key. And Druid, is the database for doing this. And they are using Druid today. They are one of our customers. On top of Druid, they also use Imply Pivot. Pivot is an Imply's product. It's an easy tool to do self-service analytics and rapid drill-down exploration and on data that's backed by Druid. And inside Twitch, everybody in Twitch uses Pivot, including the CEO of Twitch uses Pivot on a day-to-day basis to look at the metrics of what's happening right now in Twitch ecosystem.
I think this is like our first Pivot name drop. Can you explain a little bit about what Imply Pivot is?
Absolutely. Imply Pivot is one of our products. Imply Pivot provides a visualization layer on top of Druid, and it is best suited for self-service analytics on Druid data. It also provides rapid drill-down capabilities. And you can go, it provides multiple visualization options that you can use to create dashboards and data cubes. Not only that, you can use Pivot to share your dashboards to your team. You can embed Pivot in your own applications. Some of our customers have white labeled Pivot and exposed Pivot to their customers too. That's also possible.
Awesome. I figured, like, I know what that is. And David, you know what that is. But just for our listeners, just wanted to make sure that we got that well defined. But one thing, so we've been talking obviously about a lot of data. Part of the reason for that is, a lot of streaming data, and that's not going to stop anytime in the future. And then on top of that is the need for, there's a lot of real-time data, right? So not things that get ingested overnight, things that are happening in real time. And when we talk about real time, like that's kind of, I've had a lot of work with real time decisioning. At my last company, we had a customer decision engine that collected and analyzed customer data using AI and machine learning. And one of the things that you could do is as you navigated a website, it helped create propensity models and propensity scores to figure out how to customize the experience as you browsed, right? So among other things, but the data it was collecting real-time data, combining it with historical data, and then depending on the company, that could be just massive amounts of data. If you think about, global brands, they could have any number of customers on their digital properties at any given time, right? That's just one small example, but everything we've talked about today, I feel like has a layer of real-time data, and that's another way that I think Druid really shines. And we talk about, how data, we need real-time data to inform decisions, not just in, say, like this very specific real-time decision engine example. But can you tell us a little bit more about maybe some customers that we have that are using Druid to really process and analyze and ingest real-time data for decisioning purposes?
Sure. That's definitely a good use case for Druid. And some of our customers, they use Druid for real-time decisioning, not only for looking into the analytics and making decisions, but having machines to make decisions as well automatically. So before we drill deeper into that, let's try to understand what real-time decisioning is all about.
I once did a whole study on it, and it was fascinating to see how many people defined it differently. And, you know, it kind of almost was on like a use case by use case basis. But like, let's define it here right now. What is real-time decisioning and in terms of what we're talking about?
Yeah, definitely. But let's get to the basics, right? So real-time decisioning, let's split that into two. What's decisioning, right? Let's forget systems. As humans, we make decisions on a day-to-day basis. So we make decisions based on some data at our disposal. Same thing with systems too. They need data. And they need massive amounts of data to make those decisions. They need data of what's happening right now and what happened before. The propensity model that you talked about, Rina, in your previous company, for sure they would have collected the clickstream events of all their customers to see what's happening right now, and also what happened before, what that particular individual did doing right now and what they did before. That means they need to collect this massive amounts of data, isn't it not?
Mm-hmm.
So you need data, that's number one. And number two, we're talking about real-time here, real-time decisioning. So what's needed for real-time decisioning? We humans can, looking at the data, we might take a couple of seconds, we might a couple of minutes to make a decision. But we want machines to make a decision right away. So you talked about your example about the system deciding what to show on the screen based on their clickstream pattern. If that system takes more than 5 seconds, then obviously you're losing it right there, right? So that means your decisioning system should be in a position to make that decision really, really fast, maybe in less than a second. To make a decision in less than a second, it needs to query the data. So probably your queries have to respond in less than 100 milliseconds so the system could take remaining 900 milliseconds to make a decision. That means you need a system that can provide faster query response time. Make sense so far?
Oh yeah, 100%. I think that system was doing like sub 200 milliseconds, if I remember correctly.
We definitely need to talk to them and see what they're using, and probably we can sell them through it. They can do much better than what they're doing
today. I know.
Today.
I was trying to dig into it because I was like, I wonder if they do, but I'm not entirely sure. But again, they're not the only folks out there that are using, you know, real time data in collaboration with AI and machine learning.
Yeah. So let's get back to what's needed, right? The first, like I said, you need a system to collect all this data real time and store and do analytics on both real time and historical. Second, you need a system that responds in less than 100 milliseconds so that the decision can be made immediately, which is a low latency queries. The third, machines are not going to take rest, right? There could be multiple decision systems running parallelly. That means they're all firing queries like anything. So what that translates to? Higher concurrency. So it translates to much, much, much higher concurrency. Let's say if you have 1,000 people sitting and clicking on the button at the same time, it won't be 1,000 queries at the same second. But if you have 1,000 machines, not 1,000 machines, but 1,000 instances of this decision systems querying the system, it could be 1,000 queries at the same millisecond. That's possible. That means you need to have a system that can support highly concurrent queries. So these are three things that you need to building any real-time decisioning system. And guess what? Druid is fit for that. Druid has direct connectors to Kafka, Kinesis, like we mentioned before, like what our customers are using right now. So we can plug into those real-time system, capture all that events that are happening right now. And Druid provides analytics on both historical and real-time data together. So you do not have to build two different systems like what game analytics did prior to Druid. So one system is good enough. The second thing is Druid is built for low latency queries. Twitch was firing about close to 100,000 queries a day. And I was talking about Atlassian's use case about close to 1 million queries a day. All were performing in about sub-second. And that's a kind of a latency that you need for real-time decision-making systems as well. A third, higher concurrency. Druid supports higher concurrency at the lowest cost, and these decision systems can run this queries much faster than they need and make the decisions what they need to make.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, yeah, you asked about an example. I forgot about that.
Well, I kind of gave an example. It was my turn.
It was my turn for an example. Exactly. We definitely talked to your previous company for sure. Yeah.
Yeah. I wonder now. I'm trying to think. I don't remember what the system was built on, or if I can reveal that, you know, company secrets. okay. So we've really dug into exactly what you should use Druid for, what challenges folks have been facing when handling mass amounts of data, you know, and where that fits and, you know, what they come to us for. However, you know, if somebody is looking to, like, they heard this, like, I want to get started with Druid. David, where do folks go? How do people get started with Apache Druid? Where should they go?
Yeah, great question. So, you know, being an Apache project, it's obviously free to get started. So you can go on to the druid.apache.org site and just download, you know, Druid and get started immediately. If you're looking for a cloud service, so where you don't have to worry about managing the database or managing the infrastructure underneath the covers, and you don't really want to become an expert in Druid's ins and outs, then the really easy way to get started is just, you know, get an account and start on a free trial with Imply Polaris, which is our database as a service for Druid. So two really easy ways to get started right off the bat.
Awesome. And then if they want more, Mutu, you and your team can do proofs of concept. Come talk to us. We can go through and kind of figure out what is needed, what you're doing, where things can be optimized. Once again, thank you, David. Thank you, Mutu, for being here and really walking us through everything that Druid has to offer. If you want more information on Druid or Imply, please visit imply.io. Until then, keep it real.